अभी आपको ना सुनाना है। आ रहा है देखिए सर। हेलो ठीक है, ऑडियो ठीक है। पहला वाला ये वेरिफिकेशन इतना बढ़िया आ रहा है सर, शुरू करिए।
बंद कर दीजिए, नॉइज आएगा। ठीक है, इसको बंद कर दीजिए, वॉल्यूम कम कर दीजिए।
पहला वाला ये वेरिफिकेशन
गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, सॉरी फॉर देर वॉज सम टेक्निकल प्रॉब्लम, सो वी गॉट डिलेड बाई 10 मिनट्स और सो। सो आई होप एवरीबडी इज़ रेडी नाउ। सो टुडे विल बी टेकिंग टू लेक्चर्स, वन ऑन द वेरीफिकेशन ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट लेंसेज एंड देन फॉलोड बाई द मॉडिफिकेशन ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट लेंस पैरामीटर्स। सो फर्स्ट वेरीफिकेशन ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट लेंसेज, everything needs verification to be called the best, and this is true for contact lenses also. So in this class we'll be talking about the why should we verify a contact lens, what is the importance of verifying a contact lens, then which are the instruments needed for the verification of contact lenses, and which are the parameters to be verified, parameters such as base curve, power of a contact lens, overall diameter or the size of the contact lens, thickness of the contact lens, and edge profile, surface quality, material, etc., etc. So, and after that, difference between the RGP and soft contact lens verification, and finally the quiz, that is your favorite. So contact lens verification undertaken at two stages. First, in the laboratory itself, once the fabrication of contact lenses process is finalized, then the verification of the parameters is done before delivering the lens to the eye care practitioner, and in order to ensure that the lenses are made as per the orders of the eye care practitioner. After that, once the lens is received in the clinic, then clinician must once again verify the lens parameters before dispensing it to the patient, just to cross check if there is any human error. And for soft contact lenses, since you cannot do any modifications on soft contact lenses, so especially for soft contact lenses, on eye fit is also another indicator of whether a contact lens has been manufactured to the specifications that you had ordered. So what is the importance of contact lens verification? So verification of contact lenses is advisable to be done upon the receipt of the contact lens rather than during the dispensing visit. So it's better to verify the contact lens as soon as you receive it from the laboratory, so that if there are any changes to be made, then you can send such contact lenses back to the lab for further modifications, and also to know if it contains the parameters which were ordered, and also to know if the contact lenses meet the established standards like ANSI standard and all. So if you check them beforehand, then there are less chances of in-house modification. That will save your chair time, and it is ensured that only the correct lens is being dispensed to the patient, and that leads to less chances of unsuccessful wear and overall more patient satisfaction. And if after some time, what happens if patient develops some symptoms, then if you have already verified the contact lens parameters at the baseline visit, at the baseline, then you can always verify whether these symptoms are because of the changes in contact lenses or patient related symptoms. Like some parameters, like some lenses, especially the high decay lenses, they get flexed on the eye, especially if there is high amount of corneal toricity. So both RGP and soft contact lenses have the similar kind of parameters, but as the other day we discussed, a glass prescription contains three elements. One is the spherical element, the cylindrical element, and its axis. These are the essential components. So likewise, the contact lenses also have three major parameters, and these major parameters are the base curve of a contact lens, or the back optic zone radius, the power of the contact lens, the refractive power that has been prescribed, and the overall diameter or the overall size of the contact lens. The base curve is being verified using radioscope, keratometer, or there are a number of other instruments as well. Power is verified using lensometer, manual or automated, both types of lensometers you can use, and overall diameter by the use of V gaze, also known as slot gaze, hand magnifier, even there are so many other things also, very simple things, as simple as transparent ruler you might use. These three are the major parameters of a contact lens. There are other parameters also, and these parameters include like thickness of a contact lens. So this is measured using the thickness gauge. Then there are linear parameters like base curve, diameter, peripheral curves, etc. And this is being verified using hand magnifier. Then the edge profile, simple instrument to see an edge profile is a magnifier, the hand magnifier, and surface quality also using hand magnifier, though there are other advanced instruments also. So what we are talking about in this class, we are talking about the minimum or the simplest instruments that you can have in your clinic in order to verify the contact lens parameters. And one more thing you must know, make a note, like before contact lens verification, you must soak the contact lens in the contact lens soaking solution for 12 to 24 hours. This is necessary because so that the lens takes its proper shape, and the measurements are done accurately. So coming on to the base curve or the back optic zone radius verification, there are so many instruments to verify base curve of an RGB lens, and these instruments include the radioscope, this upper one, this one. This is the radioscope. It looks like a lensometer, but it is not. And the keratometer, this is the keratometer, manual one, with little bit of modification. I'll tell you what modifications it requires in order to verify base curve. Then there is a toposcope. Then there is an instrument called Meyer French deflectometer. Then radius checking device is there. Then a topographical mapping system, like the corneal topographic system. Electrical conductivity method is also there, and by means of microspherometer. So we'll be talking about two instruments which are readily available: the radioscope and the keratometer. So radioscope, this is the radioscope instrument, and it is designed to measure the radius of curvature of anterior and posterior both the surfaces of an RGB contact lens. So this is the platform, and this is the mount on which contact lens is placed. So you put a drop of water on top of that, you put the contact lens, and this is the knob by means of which you can focus. So initially what you do, you rotate the knob so that you bring the focusing system to its upper limit, and upper side you'll find clear focus of the mirror, these radial lines kind of mirror, and whenever you find this clear mirror, you make this point to zero, aligned with the zero mark of the instrument. Then you gradually move down the focusing knob, and in the middle at around 3 diopters you'll be getting an image of the bulb filament which has been used to illuminate the mirrors. So this you'll be getting, this is just an indication and nothing to do. This will indicate like you are going in the right direction, and then if you move further down, then again you'll be getting the focused mirror like this spoke kind of pattern of the mirror. And then you read out the reading, like it was zero before when you started uppermost, and lowermost again second focus you are getting, then it is, you can read out the reading 8.2 you can make out here. So that way you measure. So this is based on the radioscope. Now let us talk about the keratometer. So this is a simple keratometer that we routinely use to measure the curvature of the cornea or the corneal power, also used in the intraocular lens implantation and in other instances also. So with a little bit of modification, what modification? To verify a contact lens power, you need to have a right angled prism, and its one surface, like this surface, is silvered. It is just to fold the path, optical path, because vertically you cannot keep the contact lens stable, so it's better to place the contact lens horizontally on the this prism surface. So if it is an RGB lens, you can keep the RGB lens on the lens holder on top of the right angled prism, and then you can make measurements. The measurement method is the same, procedure steps, everything is same as you measure the corneal curvature. Whereas if you are going to take the measurements on the soft contact lens, then you need to have a vessel inside which you keep a soft contact lens submerged in a contact lens solution. So that way you verify the anterior as well as posterior curvatures of a contact lens using a keratometer. Radioscope is not very common, it is found only in institutes, but this keratometer is everywhere. Only a little bit of this attachment you need to, this is an accessory, it does not come with the keratometer, so it's better to buy this accessory so that you can make use of your keratometer for the contact lens verification as well. Then these are the ANSI tolerance limits for the measurement of the base curve. So ranging from 0.05 millimeters up to 0.09 millimeters, that is less than 0.1 millimeter. So these are the and this is depending upon the amount of toricity. So second parameter which is to be verified is power of a contact lens, and this is verified using a lensometer. This is a manual lensometer, and you know its parts, you also know how to use it. So I'm not going to discuss about how to use a manual lensometer. So little bit of modifications. What modification? This is the lens top, if you remember. Against this lens top, on this platform you keep this spectacle lens just to check the back vertex power of a spectacle. So this is known as the lens top. This is the lens top. Here it is more clear. So this lens top, whenever you are checking the power of spectacle or contact lens, it should be fully tightened. If you loosen it even half a screw, then it will give you the wrong readings. So it should be tightened properly. And in order to verify contact lens, in order to check the contact lens power, this will not do. You need to have a smaller sized lens stop for the contact lens. So RGB contact lens power may be checked using this. So lens stop has to be small, so that reduces the amount of light that is passing through the lens, and it is focusing the more from the central area of a contact lens, because contact lens curvature is much more as compared to spectacle lens. Its base curve is quite a bit different from the spectacle lens. So chances of error are more in case of contact lenses as compared to spectacle lenses. That is why you require a small sized lens stop. Then how to place, like spectacles, you must place the concave surface facing the lens top in order to check the back vertex power, okay. Whereas to check the front vertex power, you need to keep the positive or the front surface against the lens top in order to check the front vertex power, like the similar way as you do with the spectacle lenses. So and when checking, you look for the crisper and clear mirrors. If the mirrors are not clear, if there is any distortion of the mirrors noticed, then that indicates the poor optics, and the lens should be outrightly rejected. And you may ask your manufacturer to give you the another lens. Then there are some limitations also, like this lensometer overestimates plus power and underestimates the minus power, similar way as with the spectacle lenses. This is because the it converts the focal length, this focusing distance, into the dioptric value. So it will take measurement from here. So in case of minus lens, this much of extra measurement is being taken. In case of plus lens, it measures from here. whereas ideally it should measure from the optical center, which is somewhere here. So that way if you apply theory of thick lens, then from the plane it should measure from the plane. So plane falls here in case of minus lens, and it falls here in case of plus lens. That is why the similar thing happens with the spectacle lens also. This manual kind of lensometer overestimates the power of plus lens or the positive lens used to correct hyperopia, whereas it underestimates values are little less than normal. Like instead of plus 15 diopters, it would be 15. If you have ordered plus 15 diopters contact lens or a spectacle lens, when you verify on this manual lensometer, you will be getting like 15.5 or 15.37 kind of this thing. But that is why the tolerance limits are higher for the higher numbers, whereas for minus numbers also it underestimates. Instead of minus 15, it will be it will give you a reading of like 14.5, 14.75, 14.87 or like that. That you can calculate. I am just taking an example. So these are the tolerance limits for spherical power. So up to 5 diopters of spherical power, a tolerance limit is plus minus 0.12 diopters. From 5 to 10 diopters, it is 0.18 diopter. From 10 to 15 diopter, the tolerance limit is plus minus 0.25 diopters. For 15 to 20, 0.5 diopter. And this tolerance limit ANSI has decided, because if you are checking using the manual, even with this automated lensometer also, here also you need to change the lens stop. If you are not changing the lens stop, then you are going to get higher errors in your measurement. So these were the tolerance limits for and spherical power. And for cylindrical power, up to 2 diopters of cylinder, there is a tolerance limit of plus minus 0.25 diopters. 2 to 4 diopters, it is plus minus 0.37 diopters. And more than 4 diopters, there is a tolerance limit of 0.5 is allowed. And what are the tolerance limits for the cylindrical axis? Up to 0.5 to 1.5 diopters, up to plus minus 8 degrees this side or that side is permissible, whereas cylinders which are above 1.5 diopters, then up to 5 degrees this side that side tolerance limits are permitted. But these limits seem little too much. Actually, if the cylinder mount is 1.5 and if the axis is wrong by 5 degrees, patient is going to get his vision is going to get affected. It's not only quantity of vision, like instead of reading 6.5, patient might read 6.5 partial or maybe 6.6, and also the quality of vision will be reduced, like his contrast sensitivity will be not as good. So for bifocal refractive errors, add power in the power, plus minus 0.5 diopter is permissible. And as far as segment height goes, it is 0.10 millimeter is permissible. Now the major parameter to be verified is the overall diameter or the size of the lens. If this were the contact lens, then the maximum size passing through its radius. So to measure the overall diameter, there are number of instruments, like there is a measuring magnifier, there is a V gauge you can use, and there are divider, even you can make use of transparent rule if you are expert enough, and also there is a micrometer and spheres. So how to check contact lens diameter using a magnifier? This 10x magnifier is being used. This side has got, this is transparent, and this side has got a scale, millimeter scale, like this scale on the other side. This is the ocular side 10x loop, and on the other side there is a millimeter scale. So there will be scale out here. So what you can do, you can place the contact lens. He's holding the contact lens right here with the help of his middle finger in order to measure the lens diameter. So that way you can measure. So concave side should face the scale, otherwise it will keep on moving and there are chances of scratching of the lens also. So concave side of the contact lens, like this is the concave side, so this side should face the examiner's eye, so should face the instrument. Here it is more clear, as you can make out, this is the contact lens and then there is a millimeter scale. So from this point up to this point you can measure the maximum reading that you get would be the overall diameter of this RGP contact lens. Then another device is the V gauge. So this is a, this may be a metallic or a plastic gauge. So there is a groove, this is wider this side and this is narrower this side. On the other side this is wider, this is narrower. So what you do, it can be used, the range of this instrument is up to 6 to 12.5 diopters, and this the groove in the picture is ranging from 7 millimeters up to 15 millimeters diameter, because you have the lenses not less than 6 or 7 millimeters like contact lenses used for keratoconus. So you just slip down the RGP lens with the concave side facing the ruler from this side, from the wider side, and wherever it stops, like in this case this is the contact lens, it has stopped somewhere here, so you can record the reading. So it is 8.1 or so. So that way you can record the corneal lens, the RGP lens diameter with the help of a V groove or V gauze or slot gauze also. So there is a, this groove, the shape of the groove is like V, like this V. So then there is one more method. You can keep the, hold the lens on your forefinger or with the help of two fingers like this, and then you can use this divider. So you can keep it like this, and then again you can move it and place it on the simple transparent ruler, simple ruler, not even transparent. So as you can see here, the measurement is 11 millimeters. So 5 millimeters, 10 millimeters and one more millimeter. So it is the diameter of this RGP lens is 11 millimeters. Okay, and what simply you can do, if you have a transparent ruler like this, this is not a transparent, if you have transparent ruler that comes in your geometry box, then you can directly place the lens concave side facing the ruler onto the ruler, and then also you can measure, or you can place this ruler on top of the lens like this, and then you can measure. But you have to have some experience of measuring. So for beginners, you must verify with the help of other methods also, advanced methods, where the chances of error are less, because 1 millimeter tolerance is not allowed. So these are the limits, ANSI limits. So only 0.05 diopters of this thing diameter change is allowed. Then coming on to the thickness verification. So till now we have discussed three major parameters. One was the base curve of a contact lens, the other one was the power of a contact lens, and the third one was the overall diameter or the size of the contact lens. So these parameters, they belong to you, basically you prescribe. Rest of the parameters you don't have to, you don't have much saying. So like the manufacturer decides about the design of the contact lens. So the other parameters include the thickness verification, the thickness of the lens. You can measure the thickness either in the central area or near the periphery or in the edge region or lenticular junction if it is a lenticular kind of design, or any other specific point anywhere on the screen, on the lens, you can check the thickness depending upon the problems. So using the dial thickness gauge, this is the manual kind of dial thickness gauge, and it is calibrated to 0.01 millimeters. So you just push this, and then there is a spring in it, so you place the contact lens and then you take the measurement from here. Okay, so the center thickness is measured at the geometrical center of a contact lens as well as its optical center. So mostly the center thickness is measured, and there are certain minimum thickness norms, and these norms are for the minus 3 diopter of lens. So for a PMMA lens or a hard lens, the central thickness is should be around 0.1 millimeters. Peripheral thickness or the edge thickness should be 0.12 millimeters. For cellulose acetate butyrate material, it should be 0.16 for this central thickness and 0.12 for the peripheral thickness. These standards are given there for the safety and efficacy of a contact lens. Best compromise between the safety, if the, you make the lens thicker, then there won't be lens would be safer, more durable, there will be less flexure, at the same time there will be less amount of oxygen that can pass through, like decay by T. So if T is more, then oxygen flux across the lens would be less. So for silicon acrylate, it should be 0.15 central thickness and 0.13 for the edge thickness, because these lenses are oxygen permeable lenses. And for silicon fluorosilicon acrylate, like the fluoropore material that we are using in India, so central thickness should be 0.14 millimeters and the edge thickness should be 0.15 millimeters. Then when you are checking the center thickness like this at the center area, so thickness you are checking along this meridian, so this would be the axial thickness, like axis or the axial length of the eyeball along that direction, like the line of sight or the line of sight of the patient. And if you're checking the thickness towards the edge, this would be the radial thickness along this direction. You're not measuring like this. That is why there are two types of edge lifts, axial edge lift and then the radial edge lift. So the similar way you are checking the radial thickness in the periphery and the axial thickness at the center of the contact lens. Here are the tolerance limits. It is for center thickness, it is 0.02 diopters. Then the edge profile verification. So there are a number of instruments used, like edge molding, like there is a projection magnifier. This is the instrument, and then Erman profilometer, and then you can even do a simple palm test to feel the edge profile, and this comes with experience. So, and then there is a radioscope with little bit of modification, you can check the edge profile as well. So these are the different types of edge profiles. So if edge is like this, this is pointed towards the cornea, and it won't be that comfortable. Patient might develop SPKs and all. And this is blunt kind of, this is squared, then there will be much lens movement. And this is the rounded, this rounded shape is the best. And if you look at this profile, this is more pointed, and this is pointed towards the cornea. This is away from cornea. This will have more interactions with the lid. This will have more interactions on the cornea, and this is the ideal edge shape. Okay. Then coming on to the lens surface, lens and surface quality assessment, both for the RGP and soft contact lenses may be done. Instruments used are again the magnifying 10x loop. You can keep the lens against this 10x. There is a magnifying lens out here, so then you can use it. Then there is a projection magnifier, this instrument, and then there is a contact lens optical quality analyzer. Then there is a dark field microscope also. Then Meyer fringe deflectometer. So it's better to have such advanced instruments, but it is not possible in small clinics. So in your clinic, you may take this magnifying 10x loop is sufficient, and for institutes and also where the lot of research work is being done, advanced instruments are required. What are the qualities of a contact lens that you check for? These are the finish of the contact lens, the workmanship, the polish, whether it is properly done or not, then about the edge form, about the transitions from one zone to the next, and tint if it is prescribed, and the material qualities as well. So verification soft versus RGP lenses. So since hydrogel lenses are flexible lenses, like you cannot measure their diameter directly in dry, you cannot measure their back radius curvature using radioscope directly. So if they are exposed to atmosphere, what will happen? They'll get dehydrated and they'll alter their contour. So if you leave the lens in air for even a few minutes, their shape changes due to dehydration or evaporation of the solution from the contact lens. So to verify in air space would be inaccurately done. So therefore a liquid cell would be required to measure the parameters of a soft lens. But RGP lenses you can measure in open air conditions. So coming on to your favorite quiz. So are you guys all ready with your answers? Come to chat box, then reply. So contact lenses are soaked in a solution before verification for how much of duration? For 1 to 3 hours, for 3 to 6 hours, for 6 to 12 hours, or 12 to 24 hours. Write down in the chat box A, B, C, or D, which is your answer. Yes, it is 12 to 24 hours. If you remember, this was written in one of the slides. Second question is, using keratometer, the following, which one of the following RGP parameters is checked? So using keratometer, you check the corneal curvature, or you check the base curve of a contact lens, RGP lens, or you check the power of an RGP lens, or you check the overall diameter of a soft lens. Again, I'm waiting for your responses. Yes, correct. This time all of you have replied correctly, 100% result. So you check the base curve. Whoever were thinking of corneal curvature, though you check corneal curvature using keratometer, but it is asking RGP parameter. So this is soft lens, you are not checking. Power you are checking with the lensometer. So base curve only, you are not checking the corneal curvature either. Another question, ANSI tolerance limits for 10 to 15 diopters range. If you are checking, if you are verifying the contact lens power, then how much is the tolerance limit in between 10 to 15? Okay, again I am waiting for your, wow, 100% accurate. This 10 to 15 is, it is high power, so it is 0.25 diopters. Beyond 15 is 0.5 or so. Another question, which are the three major components of a contact lens prescription? Major components I am talking about. Repeatedly I discussed with you, there are three major components. Again I am waiting for your responses on the chat box. Come up with your answers. Sagar, be careful, read the question once again and then reply. So the three major components of a contact lens prescription are the its base curve, its power and overall diameter. In the same sequence you prescribe, you write down the base curve like 8.6 oblique, then you write down the power minus 3.00 like that and oblique, and then you write down the overall diameter like 14.2, and then also if it is ready-made lens, then you can write down the even the make and the brand and all. Okay, the last question would be, the radioscope is based on which principle? This is a tricky question because I don't know where I missed while making these slides. I had written this principle's name there. So it is based on the Drysdale's principle, okay, of aerial image. Thank you so much. This is not all. There is one more presentation that has to be done today itself. So once you have verified the contact lens and if everything is all right, then you need not to modify any contact lens. So what will you do? You will try the contact lens on the patient. If the patient is comfortable, if its fluorescein pattern is okay, if its movement and all assessment, everything is okay. Of course, after settlement of 15-20 minutes, depending upon the patient, depending upon the whether patient is first timer or patient is habitual contact lens user, or depending upon so many factors that we are not going to discuss right now. So if everything is okay, then you can dispense the lens. In case if you found something like lens is little maybe tighter, then what will you do? You will modify maybe the contact lens diameter. You can make it little smaller diameter, little bit smaller, then the contact lens is going to be little bit fit will be looser on the eye. The same way you can change the base curve diameter also. There are so many factors that you can change. So if you find anything, then you can modify. How to modify, how to go about it, what are the different instruments used, what is the kit, what are the methods, how to perform, we'll discuss in this class. So in this class we'll be discussing about the advantages of contact lens modifications. Why do we perform contact lens modification? Then about the contact lens toolkit, what and all you should have in your clinic to modify a contact lens, and then which are the contact lens modifications, on which parameters you can easily do at your clinic. These are the power adjustments. You can little bit increase or decrease the power of a lens. So or polishing you may perform on an RGP lens. You may change the blending transitions or junction zones, you can blend, or you may adjust the peripheral curves, you can reduce the overall diameter of a contact lens that we were discussing just now. And then most importantly, what are the contraindications of to contact lens modifications, in which situations, in which conditions, in which lenses you must not perform a contact lens modification, or it is not at all possible. So what are the advantages? Like sending a lens to the laboratory for modifications could be a waste of time. It will kill your time as well as patient's time, and that may cause unnecessary delay. If you are sending, then it will take 1 day to for pick up the lens from your clinic, then it will take 1 or 2 days for modifications, and then it will take might take 1 or 2 days, another 1 or 2 days if you are in a different city, like the manufacturer is in Delhi and you are in Bangalore based, then it will take for couriering and all, it will take another 2-3 days. So 4-5-6 days will be lost that way. So that will be inconvenient for the patient as well. Sometimes patients are in hurry, so it's better to have modification tools with you in your clinic, so whenever possible you can do your modifications. So modification is always preceded by verification. You will first verify if there is any problem, then of course you need to modify the lens, and it is done to improve the fit as well as comfort to the patient. And then you may also remove the coating of film on the lens surface. As soon as lens comes, there will be so many chemicals and all sometimes on the contact lens surface. So if you directly give this lens to the patient for wearing, immediately he'll start feeling like stinging, burning, itching, redness of eye, lot of profuse watering and all. And if it is a first time wearer, then patient might not take the contact lens, he'll get frightened. So it's always better to clean the lens properly, and of course disinfect the lens also prior to inserting it, trying on the patient's eye. So you may blend the sharp junctions or edges, that will again give the immediate comfort to the patient, and that results in the successful wear. If you have tried the lens on the patient is not that comfortable, and if you find like the edges are sharper, or the transitions from the base curve to the peripheral curves, or in between the peripheral curves are sharp, then you can blend the junctions, and immediately not only comfort will be increased, but better tear exchange also will be done that way. So if there is a poor tear exchange, then also you can modify, you can blend the junctions. Then what is the kit? This kit of modification kit includes so many things. I'm giving you the list. You can pause the video, recorded video, and you can note down these kits. Most importantly, you must have an RGP polisher unit. This is unit, this is motorized. So, and also like polishing compound, and then sponge tool you must have, then diameter gauge and all. Double sided cloth is very important, just to stick the cloth on the tools. And then velveteen polishing pad is also you must have. This is the 3-inch flat polishing disc. This is the disc, you stick it here, and then you polish, apply the polish, and then this rotates. This is the suction cup or lens holder, like how there is a lens like the scleral lens, or there is a lens plunger also, lens holder. So it is similar kind of thing, but it is of the larger size, and its grip is much stronger as compared to lens wearing suction cup. And then there is a metric measuring magnifier, there is a millimeter scale as well, and there is a magnification magnifying lens out here, so you can observe the changes that you make simultaneously. So what and all you can do? First, you can make power adjustments also. What is the range of power adjustment? From minus 0.75 to plus 0.5 diopters. This is very important. So if your lens has come and after settling for 15, 20 or 25 minutes, if you have done over, if you have checked the vision is not appropriate, little bit less than what you had prescribed, then what you can do, if the power has come appropriately, then you can over refract, and if there is a acceptance in over refraction, then you can modify. If the power what you prescribed was not there and there was a little bit of difference of 0.5 or 0.75 diopters, that also you can modify. So similarly, so you can modify the contact lens power, of course the RGB power, never the soft contact lens power. How much? Ranging from minus 0.75 to plus 0.5. It is done by changing the anterior curvature. So like what you do in LASIK, you flatten the positive curvature to correct the minus power. Similarly, you do here also. So contact lens is held using this suction cup holder, this cup holder, and then this is the velveteen sponge covered with rotating drum. So this you can place in the rotating drum. These are the radius tools. So this is how it is undertaken here. So for adding minus power, you reduce the central portion, you make the central portion flatter. Okay, to add the plus power, you reduce the mass from here. Okay, you grind it here in the periphery or mid peripheral region. So that way you do. And second thing is polishing. How to polish a lens? It removes the surface debris, and many times in 1 to 1.5 years time, depending upon the care and maintenance, sometimes patient comes with the like deposits of patient RGP lens deposits, or patient comes with the scratches and all. So what you can do, you can polish the lens in your clinic, or maybe you can send the lens to the laboratory for polishing and all if you don't have that much of time, and you may charge from the patient polishing charges. Sometimes it is done free of charge as well. So polishing removes the debris from the surface that blurs the patient's vision and causes discomfort due to roughening of the surface, and there will be poor wettability, so poor comfort will be there. Okay, there will be poor vision as well, because there will be a layer, proteinaceous layer on the contact lens surface. So it's always better to polish such lenses, and it is held using this kind of holder. This is holder, the similar kind of holder that we discussed just now. Then this is the polish. There are so many, this is one of the brands, there are so many brands, any brand, good brand polish you can take. This is the polishing machine. This is rotating, there is a motor inside this box, and these are the polishing pads for different lenses having different contact lens parameters. Then this drum tool is being used with the sponge. This is how to polish the front surface. So front surface is convex surface, and for concave surface you need to have a convex kind of this sponge tool. For front surface you have to have a concave kind of sponge, so that way you polish. This rotates like this, this spins, and you are touching the lens very gently. If you are applying excessive pressure, then lens parameters are going to be changed. So you have to be very cautious, you have to be very careful, you have to be just kind of feather touch you need to give. Then third is the blending of transition zones. Like if you look at this cross section of contact lens, this is the base curve diameter and this is the peripheral curve. This is the junction of these two curves. So if you grind the lens, then you get junctions like this, very sharp junctions. So if patient wears this contact lens, then this junction is going to be indenting on the cornea. It will be rubbing onto the cornea and this lens won't be comfortable at all to the patient. So what manufacturers do, they just blend the junction like this. So if this dotted line was the original shape and this is the blending, so blending is being performed. So this blending of sharp edges leads to increase in the patient comfort. It improves the tear exchange, as we discussed earlier. Also, this kind of seals, if not completely seals, it reduces the tear flow underneath the, if here is the cornea, so this tear flow decreased. And if it is like this, then there will be much more amount of tear coming inside and going out on each blink. So it improves tear exchange also, and junctions are present between the base curve and the intermediate curve, and between the intermediate curve and the peripheral curves. So curvature of this base curve is 7, for example, and the curvature of this, radius of curvature of the peripheral secondary curve is 8. So what tool would you use to blend this junction? So this is 7, this is 8. You can take midway, like 7.5 tool. So 7 is steeper, 8 is flatter, 7.5 is in between. So in between radius of curvature tool you must take, okay, for the smooth blending of the junction. You can also blend or smoothen the peripheral curve also and edge also, okay. Then there are three types of blends. Sometimes even you order, experienced contact lens practitioners at the first visit itself, or looking at the lens that patient is already wearing, the amount of blends that have been done and patient is asymptomatic, or if the patient is symptomatic, then they change the amount of blending. And these blends are of the three types: the light blend, medium blend and heavy blend. So blending is done also because you change the you flatten the periphery of a contact lens. At the same time, because the cornea towards the periphery, it flattens just to match the contour, but it flats, it gets flattened gradually, and your lens is not gradual. So just to make the lens gradual flattening, you need to blend the junctions. So also there is a unit in which you can measure. So using the hand magnifier, you can measure the amount of blending, and its unit is in seconds. So light blend is 5 seconds, medium blend is corresponding to 10 seconds, and the heavy blend corresponds to the 15 seconds. Now the fourth one is the adjusting the peripheral curves. So there you adjusted this curve, and they're adjusting the peripheral curves. If you need to make the lens further flatter, then you can do this procedure. So for this, diamond tool is used. This is more difficult actually. It's better to send the lens to the laboratory if you're not competent enough, and then to flatten and widen the peripheral curves. So then after using the diamond tool, it will roughen the surface. Then you need to polish the lens again, and then you flatten the intermediate curve as per the norms rules. So if you are flattening the peripheral curve, then also you need to flatten the intermediate curve. Let us take this example. Though this is having two curves, suppose there is one peripheral curve here, one curve here, tri-curve lens. This is base curve, primary curve, this is secondary curve. And if you are trying to, if you are trying to flatten this curve, okay, then if you are flattening this, if you are not flattening this, then there won't be gradual change. So if you are flattening this, then also you need to flatten to a lesser amount this secondary curve as well. And if you are changing this curve, then definitely lens fit is going to alter. So mostly this is not touched, only the peripheral, most peripheral curve and the secondary curves are touched. So then as you can see here, it is more clear. There will be very slight change. This is the base curve. You can make out there is a little bit of curvature out here. Then this is, that was the primary curve. Base curve is primary curve. This is the secondary curve. This is flatter going away. Okay. So if this was the original curvature for primary, this is secondary. This will go like this. And the peripheral is like this. So this is base curve. This is flatter than the base curve. This is the flattest. This is the peripheral curve. So to change the peripheral curve, you also need to change a little bit the intermediate curve. Okay. Then fifth one is how to reduce the overall lens diameter. So what regarding diameter, what you can do, you can only decrease the diameter. You cannot increase the diameter, which is not possible. So you can just decrease the overall diameter, like from 9.4 to 9.2 millimeters. That you can do. You cannot increase like from 9.4 to 9.6. That you can't do. You cannot add material all around the periphery. You can just remove. So it is kind of destructive kind of procedure. So you can only decrease the power. So for an RGP lens, reduction in overall diameter by 0.1 millimeter equals to 0.2 millimeters of peripheral curve blending. That you must keep in mind. And remember that reducing overall diameter will loosen the fit. Okay. And similar thing happens with the optic zone diameter. What does that mean? So if you are decreasing the diameter, say if this was the diameter, this D, B, this was the diameter, and if you are cutting down this much portion from both the sides, it will be cut down. So the diameter will be less. From this much to this much, this is smaller line, dotted line is smaller as compared to this line. That way you reduce. But at the same time, what is happening, you are also reducing the sag. This is the sag value, is less, this is more, this is less. So lesser the sag, looser the fit or flatter the lens. On the other hand, if you are increasing the diameter, like if you have got a contact lens trial set that has a diameter of 9 millimeters, and if you want to prescribe 9.1 or 9.2 diameters, so what you can do at the time of fitting itself, if the lens is little looser and rest of the fittings are parameters are okay, then depending upon your experience, you may order from 9.0 to 9.2 diameter. But here you can only reduce. When you are reducing, you are flattening the lens. So fit will be lens will be flat and fit will be looser fit. So for that you use this kind of V kind of conical stone. So you are grinding these, and then edging tool is also used. So after that you need to, like you have roughened the edge, then you need to appropriately blend the junctions. Looking at the projection of the edge of the lens, and then you need to blend, followed by polishing of the lens. So all the three things are to be done together if you are reducing the overall diameter. So if you are reducing the overall diameter, you are making the lens flat and fit becomes loose. Same thing happens with the base curve diameter also. If you are increasing the diameter, you are tightening the lens, okay? You are steepening the curvature, you are tightening the lens. So then this probably would be the last slide. So what are the contraindications of contact lens modifications? Like not all RGP lenses should be modified, and you must know the specifics of the lens that you are attempting to modify. For example, if the lens has undergone plasma coating, so if there is a plasma coating, if you are trying to modify, the modification will damage the plasma coating, and that will negatively affect the wettability of the surface and overall comfort, and the purpose of the coating would not be solved. So you can modify, but if you can send the lens back to the lab for coating, then only. So maybe you can modify, or maybe you can send for modification also, but if you are modifying, then it would be better that you will be seeing the result also, and then you can send the lens for coating, plasma coating or whatever kind of coating has been applied. And one more thing, for high decay fluorosilicon acrylate lenses, they need to be modified. If you are modifying fluorosilicon acrylates, what will happen during modification? Heat is being generated, and this heat affects the material qualities. It will interact with the material qualities, and it might damage the optics of the lens. The parameters of the lens might change, and that also will negatively affect the wettability of the surface. So if you are of course, you are simultaneously using the liquid whenever you are grinding, you are using the cooling liquid or water or whatever solution, but at the same time you must these materials like fluorosilicon acrylates are more sensitive to heat. Even light changes in heat might change the optics of the lens. And also, if your RGP lens is posterior aspheric, then it should not be modified. Aspheric surface should not be modified. Posterior surface is mostly aspheric. So, and such lenses, they do not require also to be modified. So posterior surface of an aspheric lens should not be modified. But if you have to modify, then you can modify their anterior surface. Like you can make changes, you can change the power a little bit, if you want to increase or decrease power, that you can do from the front surface, but back surface should not be touched. Remember, contact lens modification cannot be performed in a soft lens, as discussed at the beginning, because and most of the times these lenses are cast molded, and if this lens does not suit the patient, then you can go for the different design, and mostly power and all is accurate only. Again, the quiz time. So the first question is, blending of junctions leads to what? What kind of change that you achieve when you blend junction? So it improves the tear exchange. B is reduced tear exchange, increase the sharpness of the edges, and it reduces the patient comfort. Come up with your questions. Wow, so quick reply, and accurately also, it will improve the tear exchange. If you are blending the junctions, then there will be more tear exchange taking place, and this lens would be more comfortable as well. And following is not included in the contact lens modification kit. Then if you remember the kit, question is looking difficult, but it is not. Wow, all of you have replied correctly. That means you are able to understand. I am able to explain you. I am able to make you understand. So following is not included in the contact lens modification kit. Polishing compound, yes or no? Probably yes. Diameter gaze, also yes. One-sided tape, there was one tape, if you remember, for the cloth attachment. Lens holder with spinner, of course, yes. Sponge tool, also there. Let's see the answer. This is not one-sided, two-sided tape is required. Then the third question is, you can alter the contact lens power by modification. How much power you can alter in a contact lens, in an RGP lens? So what was the range? Like plus 0.75 to plus 0.5 adapters, minus 0.75 to minus 0.5 adapter, minus 0.25 to plus 0.5 adapter, or from minus 0.75 to plus 0.5 adapter. I'm waiting for your responses. Come up with your responses. Wow. Yes, a few more to come. All of you are saying D. Let's see which is the yes. All of you are right. Then the probably the last question. So can modifications be performed in a silicone hydrogel lens? Silicone hydrogel, we did not take this name. So can you think for a moment and then reply? Come up with your answers. Apply your logic and then reply. Apply your logic. Silicone hydrogel lenses, can you perform modifications or you can't? Is it possible to perform a modification on a silicone hydrogel lens? First, what type of lens is this? Silicone hydrogel is a hard lens, semi-soft lens, soft lens, or what? Of course B. Yes, you cannot perform because it is kind of soft lens. So we discussed soft lenses, you cannot perform the modifications. One more question is there. Okay, so reduction of overall diameter by 0.1 millimeter equals to how much peripheral curve bending, blending, if you remember? Yes, Anjali, it is a soft contact lens. Yes, Gini. So reply to this question now. 0.1 millimeters of overall diameter reduction is equivalent to, is equals to how much of peripheral curve blending? How much of peripheral curve blending will be required? Shweta says C. All of you C. Okay. Yes, it is C. All of you are correct. Okay, thank you so much. Stay in house. Concentrate on your studies as your exams are upcoming. Stay healthy. Thank you. That's all for today. Thank you.